Appreciate you taking the time this morning. I got to ask you, man, have you ever been talked about this much following a week in which you did not compete, man? Your name is all over the headlines, even though you didn't fight. What do you think about that?
Yeah, it's awesome, man. You know, it's interesting times. With Khabib gone, you know, Dustin had a very impressive performance. Chandler coming in, making his mark. It's going to be a fun ride for these. If you're a fan of the lightweight division, you're in for a hell of a ride.
Yes, sir. There are so many good fights to make. Let's start with that fight. First of all, I want to ask you, can you clear it up? Why did you not fight Michael Chandler? Because we kept hearing that. Then I heard maybe there were some contract issues. Maybe there were some injuries. Are you able to explain why that fight didn't come together?
No, I mean, there's no really explanation. It's just really didn't work out. There's a lot of different reasons. Nothing's too specific. But I think he fought exactly who he was supposed to fight.
Fair enough. So you see him come in, man. Obviously, he was this, you know, hot prospect, free agent. He comes in, he makes a big splash. What were your thoughts on it? I mean, was there any frustration that you couldn't be there, or were maybe you happy to see a new name in the division and create this excitement? What were your thoughts as you watched that performance? Because it was a great one.
Yeah, it was impressive. You know, I didn't have a lot of expectations. You know, I came from World Series not that long ago, and a lot of pretty much everything they were saying about Chandler, they were saying about me, as they will continue to say about guys that are not in the UFC. People don't understand that fighting, you know, is fighting. And just because you're not in the UFC doesn't mean your, you know, your skills can't hang with those with us, you know, on any given night. You know, you've heard it thousands of times. Anybody can be anybody on any given night. And, you know, this is one of those sports that's absolutely true every time you step in there. So I was impressed with his performance. I'm happy that he's here. I'm happy that, again, it's just a weird time, you know, with the champion leaving. It makes things weird. But, you know, that leaves me at number – I was number one, now number two. Last man with the interim title. Not too happy with what it is. But many opportunities. Big fights ahead. You know, life is awesome.
Yeah, you know there's going to be some big ones. It is funny the similarities between you and Chandler, like what you guys faced. Do you remember a moment when that changed? Because, I mean, certainly nobody says that about you anymore, Justin. I mean, nobody says, does this guy belong? Now they say you're one of the most exciting guys in the sport. So do you remember how long it took for everything to turn from, you know, does this guy belong here to, holy God, this is one of the greatest guys in the division?
Yes, dude. This is the best sport on earth for so many reasons. One important one is that you're going to get the chance to shut every single person that doubts you up. When you succeed or when you fail, it is solely on your shoulders. And, you know, that's why I love this sport so much. That's why we're all such big fans of it. But, you know, you don't really focus on that, but I guarantee it was after I, you know, had that exciting fight with Michael Johnson, came in and beat him. And then, you know, the script flipped, and then I go and I take two losses, and the script flips back. You're only remembered by your last performance. That is one of the truest things in this sport. And you know, Michael Chandler is sitting pretty right now.
Yeah, no doubt. Of course, the other result was Conor McGregor losing to Dustin Poirier. I know you did a couple interviews last week, and the headlines that I saw come out of it were all, you know, Justin was happy to see Conor lose, you know, that piece of whatever, you know, I was happy to see him go down. Are you upset that people grabbed on to that line? I mean, do you regret saying that, or regret that people focused on it?
It's my fault. You know, how many times do you have to fucking shoot yourself in the foot before, you know, you put the gun down? You know, the question, you get asked these questions about these certain people and you answer them. And then, yeah, I mean, it grabs attention. People want to read it. It's an interesting topic. And so, you know, that's what they run with. But, you know, that's not even – I said that, you know, personally I enjoyed seeing someone that I consider not a good person, or, you know, who's carried themselves in the past as not a good person, get beat by someone I consider is a good person. I mean, who doesn't want to see that? I enjoyed that. But you know, he's still an elite fighter. He's still right here, you know. I wasn't shitting on the man as a I wasn't even trying to shit on him too bad. I was just fucking saying how awesome it was to see him get knocked out. He went to sleep. You know, he come out and said that he was only affected by leg kicks, and then you know, you watch, and you know, I knew immediately that fool, you know, went to another planet for, you know, maybe it was only 2 or 3 seconds, but he went to a different planet. He got put to sleep. And so, yeah, it was, you know, you've seen the video of him, that they call it the nice Conor, the mean Conor. I mean, that guy is a fucking piece of shit, and I can't forget it. Like, I'm sorry. They haven't hit me in the head enough times for me to just have that short term of a memory to just forget all everything.
Fair enough. And how do you not cheer for Dustin Poirier, right, man? Such a good guy, man, what he's gone through. So
talks positive, you know, carries himself in a positive light. Does, you know, charitable, puts charitable effort in everything he does. You know, I mean, you know, every fight that he has is based around, you know, something to help others. So, yeah, I mean, how could you not, you know, be happy for him?
No doubt. Well, the thing you keep touching on, Justin, is so true, is how many big fights are available, how many elite fighters are at lightweight. So give me an idea, the week since then, I mean, since all of these two lightweight fights happened, what's your energy been like, man? I mean, are you guys buzzing, talking about, you know, what's on the table, what's available? What's it been like for you this past week?
Yeah, it's I don't know, man. I'm at a weird time in my – I'm 32. I've been competing my whole life. You know, I really – as hungry as I am and always have been and should be, you know, there's days I got to wake up and really push myself to, you know, it's hard when I don't have somebody, you know, in front of me or a target to hit, you know, so I'm just trying to run on my treadmill. I'm trying to help Kamaru with his sparring, with all his training, with his grappling, you know, just being a body. So right now I'm just working, but yeah, I mean, I don't know. I hate to look too far ahead because the UFC will hit you with a nut shot twice, you know, in one round. So you just kind of have to stay, you know, stay within, stay prepared, stay mentally ready to get ready for a fight. And ultimately, hold your ground when it comes to, you know, I need my preparation time. I need my time to mentally prepare for these fights, to fight these guys. You know, as I get older, as I, you know, get more comfortable, I got to stop getting so comfortable, I guess. But yeah, dude, I don't know. There's big fights coming. I don't know who it's going to be. I don't know when it's going to be. I need my proper time. So I'll take 8 to 10 weeks from tomorrow if they call me. 12 weeks preferred.
Yeah, no, you got to do what's right for you, right? I mean, it's your career. You only get one of them, man. So yeah. Let me get your take on this because it has been interesting. I think everybody's debating, you know, fans, media, everybody. As you said, with Habib walking away, it gets really interesting. What's the right title fight? You know, who should be contesting for the title? And you got Dustin coming out saying, listen, I don't want to fight Michael Chandler for the title. I don't feel like he's earned it just yet. But, you know, it seems like that would be a big money fight. You know, does Charles Oliveira deserve to be in there? You got Conor McGregor saying, give me that rematch. I'll do the trilogy. So what do you think, man? As you lay it out, do you see, like, a right title fight? Like, what two guys should be in there fighting for Habib's title?
Yeah, I mean, you wouldn't be wrong to put Oliveira and Poirier in there. Yeah, that wouldn't be – nobody can argue against that. What the fuck was I going to say? Forgot. Damn it. I don't know.
Maybe it was that you needed to be in there for that title shot.
No. Well, fuck, I'll take it. I want Poirier. You know, I'm number two. You know, the shitty thing is the UFC is much more likely to put Poirier and McGregor in there before they put me and Poirier in there. That's just the truth. I hope that they do Oliveira and Poirier. You know, you can't forget the reason why this is happening with Poirier is because Dana White literally used – you know, he fucked Tony and Dustin. And he said, fuck you guys, I'm going to take Chandler out here and he's going to be the backup for this title fight. That all happened 3 or 4 months ago. You know, we are human. We have principles. We have morals. And, You know, that's what that is. That's why Dustin Poirier is saying that. I would assume, I don't know for sure, I don't talk to the guy. But when Dana White did that, October 24th, you know, he didn't just shit on Dustin Poirier. He didn't just shit on Tony Ferguson. He shit on every single fucking fighter that does it right, that wants to do it right, that wants integrity to the sport. That's what he shit on. And that's why Dustin Poirier is talking like he is.
Well, man, I certainly don't want to hand you a gun to let you shoot yourself in the foot, but I mean, it's hard not to sense some frustration right now, right? I mean, am I sensing that you're at odds right now?
No, I'm not. No. That's just the truth. I mean, you remember how upset Tony and Dustin were whenever they didn't put that fight together because there was probably $50,000 or $100,000 off on one of their contracts, and they didn't put the contract together. And those guys were ready to fight, and they put it in the public, and that shit's not right. I mean, I don't like that. I don't like that as a fighter. I don't like that being an employee, or no, I'm no fucking employee, but being someone that offers my services to a company. You know, that's not cool. You don't like to see that. And so, you know, I just look at those things. I just know that's why Dustin Poirier is saying what he's saying. That's why he will not fight Michael Chandler for the title right now. Because he did that shit in October. You know it. I know it. I mean, I don't know it, but I'm pretty sure.
It kind of reads like that to me.
I'm happy. I'm good. I just got more money than I've ever got, you know. I'm not dissatisfied. I don't want to fight anywhere else. I never want to fight for another company. This is the company to showcase your skills on the highest level. I try to be a company man from day one.
Did your mom get to retire? You said once that bell rang, she was done. Is she enjoying that retired life?
She is rejoicing. She's only been back, I think, a week or two since the fight. You know, a lot of family circumstances that prevented her from that. But she's not fully retired yet, but she's on her way out.
Fair enough. Good to see her moving in the right direction. Let me ask you about that fight, Justin. How do you think back on that fight with Habib? I mean, I'm sure you're frustrated. You didn't get the result you want, but you got to fight one of the greatest of all time. You know, you headline in Abu Dhabi, which is crazy. Yeah. I mean, the whole experience is weird. So when you look back on that, was it a frustrating time? Was it a good time? I mean, I'm sure you would have liked to walk away with the belt, but how do you remember it?
I mean, I will have no regrets to be able to have the opportunity to compete against, you know, he is great. Not only is he great, but that night he was even greater. And that's just who we are as athletes, as competitors. You know, my coach will say it over and over, but, you know, your why is ultimately the only thing that's going to drive you to do something like that we do. You know, why are you doing this? And his why that night was so big and so great. And, you know, I felt it in there. And it is what it is.
What's your why right now? You got your parents retired. You're taking care of them. Like you said, you made more money. But, you know, you said it's a little tough. What's your why right now?
It's hard, you know, because, you know, you start and you, you know, when I started, I had nothing, you know. Couldn't even pay for my coach was talking the other day how he gave me money to get a haircut. You know, I was sleeping on the ground. My mom and dad came to my apartment. I had not one piece of food in my refrigerator. I was sleeping on the ground. My mom started crying. I was like, I'm happy. I'm good. There's no problems here. Like, that's just that's where we were. That's who we are. And so you fight to gain things, you know, to get a house, to get a truck, to get a bed, to get some silk sheets. I don't know if people fight for different reasons. But once you attain those things, you know, you really have to remember what your why was. And, you know, it's a struggle daily, especially the farther along in the journey you get to stay grounded there. But ultimately, it is going to be my family every time. The people that have believed in me from day one and that have trusted in the process. My parents gave up a lot of money, you know, to get me to where I'm at right now. And, you know, I'm really enjoying paying that back, but I have to remember that, I never want to be broke again. That's important. But being the best in the world was why I started wrestling at 4 years old, was to be the best in my town, the best in my city, the state, the country. And now I get to represent the United States on a world level. So as you know, from where I came from, this is a dream come true. So I just need to stay hungry. I'm not sure, you know, it's going to be my family. But ultimately, the other day, I was thinking that you know, you either put the work in now and really are satisfied with your life, the life you've created, or you don't do that and you regret, you know, you have regrets for the rest of your life. So that's where I'm at. It's difficult. I think every single person goes through it, but you know, having Kamaru around, seeing Kamaru's work ethic, having all these guys, you know, Austin Hubbard, Drew Dober, Neil Magny, coming off losses, coming off wins, climbing ladders, it's all inspiring. So you just really need to stay inspired every day.
That's awesome, man. Well, you're clearly one of the best in the sport, and you're definitely one of the most exciting to do it, man. So hopefully that passion still drives you. Do you really have silk sheets, though, man? Does Justin Gaethje have silk sheets?
I have silk sheets. When Conor got knocked out, my coach looked at me and said, I'm taking them silk sheets away.
That's awesome, man. Hey, how's things outside of fighting? The business, man. Is the product ready to go public yet? Or, I mean, it's not for sale yet, right?
So we're taking orders. We're going to have gloves in stock next. So it's trials and tribulations. The coronavirus is a bitch. When it comes to, startup company, we started at the end of 2019, mid 2019, right into 2020. So, there's been some trials and tribulations. Trevor, his work ethic, his passion, you know, will not allow us to fail. So, you know, we'll be good.
That's awesome, man. I look forward to seeing it all, man. I hear good things about it. So, obviously, man, we're going to see you fight, I imagine, sometime soon. The name I keep hearing people throw out is Nate Diaz. I mean, it doesn't make sense from a rankings point of view, right? I mean, you deserve somebody higher up the rankings, but stylistically, I think it'd be fun, and obviously the guy's a superstar. Is that a fight that appeals to you right now, or do you feel like you deserve somebody higher up the rankings?
I mean, with the way this sport works, you know, I'm no fool. He's top three biggest superstars in the sport, even though he hasn't fought, you know, a long time. And in the position I'm in, I need a win. It could be Nate Diaz. It could be Rafael Dos Anjos. It could be Charles Oliveira. It could be Michael Chandler. It could be Conor McGregor, you know. And when I attain that win, I will, you know, then get the title shot. So a win against Nate Diaz is just as good a win right now for me as Michael Chandler, as Conor McGregor. You know, a win is a win for me. Rafael Dos Anjos. A win is a win. You know how this sport works. It's true. True is true. You've seen it countless times. It's not necessarily the right thing. It's the right business thing. So got to keep putting myself in that position.
You have definitely got the game figured out, my friend. So is there a date circled on the calendar? I mean, are there health things going on? What's the target date?
My body's 99%. Never going to be 100%. You know, at 32 years old, but I feel great. Mine's ready. I'm ready to get to work, you know, put the work in. 8 to 10 to 12 weeks from whenever they call me with an opponent. That's when I'm fighting.
So if they call you tomorrow, we can line it up 10 weeks from now?
Yes, sir.
I dig it, man. That's exciting. By the way, I'm 42, and if my body feels 50%, I'm pretty happy. So enjoy what you got right now, man.
I'm your age. I'll be feeling 62.
last thing, Justin, let me ask you, man. I mean, you laid out a lot. What's the goal this year? I mean, you touched on it. With Habib walking away, man, it really opened up the division, and it's wide open. And as you said, man, one win, and you're there for a title. So is the goal this year, I mean, is it world titles, or is it more about just stacking as much paper in the bank for your family as possible? Is this about legacy? Is it about building the highlight reel like Conor was talking about? I mean, obviously, you've got a ton of highlights already. So what are the goals this year, man?
I mean, so each of those things comes, you know, doesn't come without the other. A belt brings the money, you know, brings whatever. But, you know, I know that for one, I don't want to fight forever, you know, and, you know, I would be a fool to say that I'm going to do this for 5 or 10 more years. I know that I got, you know, 3 or 4 more years, and I'm going to make sure that I have no regrets when it comes to preparation, when it comes to anything that I can control that will, you know, define the rest of my life. So that's every day is my focus.
I love it, man. Well, it's always an honor to watch you fight, man. You make it thrilling every single time. So I hope we're doing it about 8 to 10 weeks from now. But whenever it is, man, we look forward to it.
So I'll be there.